What is he talking
about? That doesn't matter. And I say, welcome to the show. Welcome to Pot of Thunder.
Wow.
The recognized symbol of excellence in KISS podcasting. Guess who?
Sounded like the Nitro singer there for a minute.
Oh, yeah.
He's going to headbutt his computer screen over there in a minute.
Yeah. Actually, I got a Facebook message from one of our listeners just before we went on.
Wow.
One of our buddies named Anthony Corby sent me a message saying, can you please put this up for Chris? It's news from Nitro's official Facebook saying, Michelangelo Battio, expect a death metal sounding album from Nitro now that Chris Adler's in the band.
And Chris Adler is who? Should I know who he is?
Steve Adler's mom that we hear so much about.
Chris Adler, isn't he Lamb of God, I think? I want to say. Isn't he in Megadeth too now? Like, or he recorded the last Megadeth album.
I'm out
so
of the loop.
Does he headbutt cymbals? I assume he's the drummer, right?
He's the drummer. Yeah, I'm right. That's the guy. Okay.
He can headbutt cymbals while.
So he
like,
was in Lamb of God.
Bass.
He's now in Megadeth, or he's in both?
I don't know. I think he just recorded the last Megadeth album. I don't think he's in the touring band.
Okay. But go to the get the Grammy? Was he the fourth guy there when they accepted the Grammy or what?
He won the Grammy. So probably it says he won his first Grammy for Dystopia, blah, blah, blah. I don't know. I didn't see it. But anyway, he's
in
Nitro.
Well, they didn't show it on the telecast, dummy. They don't have fucking Megadeth on the primetime telecast.
I know that, but I didn't even see a picture is what I'm saying.
They don't do it. They don't throw a bone like one
Shit,
award like
no.
that.
No,
really?
Well, it's 2017,
nope.
dude.
Nope. They don't do anything for them.
Hell no.
Do they even stream it online, or do they just get some stills for your Twitter, Megadeth? Go ahead.
I have no idea, but they certainly don't show that shit on primetime anymore.
No, they don't. Did they ever?
I think so. Yeah, I think when Jethro Tull beat out Metallica, it was shown on the telecast. Yeah. But times have changed, man.
Well, that's what the metal category. I mean, they still show probably a hard rock category.
They don't show a hard rock category.
Really?
Believe me. No.
You watch it?
And who would it be?
Well, someone won.
Foo Fighters,
didn't they?
Probably.
If it was Foo Fighters, they'd show it.
Yeah,
well,
if they had
that,
an album out, they would, but they didn't. You know, otherwise, you're going to get these fucking 21 Pilots and all this other crap. It's not... Rock is not in favor. I mean, why do you need me to tell you this?
I haven't been paying attention.
Yeah, nobody cares about it on a grand scale anymore. It's in a crisis mode.
Correction, Chris Adler did tour with Megadeth, but he's splitting his time. He didn't leave Lamb of God,
so he's
downtime.
I don't really
he's
know
He's going to slum it with Nitro.
That's got to be just a recording project on downtime.
He must be an absolute stud drummer, I'm guessing.
I'm
if
sure.
This is his resume as of recently.
Yeah, when Megadeth's like, it's cool, you can split time with another band.
Yeah.
Then you must be onto something.
Yeah.
When Mustaine allows you to...
Yeah, he's really softened his stance of in recent years. You know, lit that guy on fire about 5 years ago or something. Or posted some weird selfie video ripping into him and then like fumbling around to cut it off. Remember
oh, God, what was
video?
That? Who was he talking about?
He was
about?
Complaining about...
Roadie? No, his tech. His guitar tech.
His guitar
right.
tech.
That was hilarious.
And then he demonstrated his technical proficiency.
That was fucking
with the
hilarious.
Phone.
That's one of the great... internet bits of all time. That's fucking great.
We'll have to work that into some of these drops we have here.
It's like the video equivalent of a YouTube comment, basically just blasting into somebody.
There's no predetermined thought. It was just hit on and vent.
Yeah, exactly.
If only there was
driven
like,
by pure frustration.
If only there was like YouTube and Blabbermouth in the early 80s when Mustaine was fired from Metallica.
Oh, God. Can you imagine?
We would have had some... fantastic documented stuff, even though I think there are like audio interviews of him at that point. But
guys ever have an experience where you are in a
like a clutch moment, and you have somebody there that's like your wheel man, and the guy just turns out to be a total fucking dew claw, like a total waste of skin and life. Well,
weirdo.
That was my guitar tech tonight, and I fired his ass, and I apologize to the
why
people.
Why a dew claw? What is that?
You know, we'll make it up to you sometime. I mean, maybe it'll be in Hawaii when we luau this fat pig's ass. But I'll tell you what, you guys deserve way better
little
than this.
An
exotic luau.
Maybe that's much better than what we appeared tonight. But you know what the funny thing is? He has to live with himself, and as of like right now, I will never see his stupid fucking ass again.
There we go.
Oh, he hit off 3 times, 4 times, 5 times, 6 times, 7, 8.
When was that? How long ago? Like 4 years ago? It was somewhat recent, right?
This is 2015, but that's when they posted it. I'm not sure. Might be 2015.
Yeah.
Being who he is, he should have just done a second take and like figured it out, because that makes him look silly at the end.
He was probably proud of the intensity that he delivered when he called him a dew claw.
Yeah, exactly.
Whatever that
isn't
is.
Isn't that part of a dog's foot?
Yeah, I think it is.
I was going to say,
is it the dog's thumb? Is that what it is?
I think so.
I was almost thinking
you dog thumb.
I was almost thinking some evil mythological creature.
A dog's thumb is
it's
what
it is. It's the dew claw.
Yeah, I'm looking at it now.
A waste of skin. Yes. Life. The way he says life, there is like he's singing
it
a lyric. Waste of skin and life.
Yeah, so it's the essentially what the thumb would be on a dog. On the side of the dog leg, that thumb up there.
You could, if he double tracked that line, he could put it in a new skin of my teeth verse.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
It would work.
Well, and does that mean...
That's great.
Is the meaning there... that a dog doesn't need its dew claw, that's a waste of skin.
So he could have called this guy an appendix.
Right. Is that what he's...
Okay.
Is that why he said
who
dew claw?
Knows.
Who fucking... Yeah.
who you're going to psychoanalyze the big bread machine on this program?
Good point.
It'd be a longer episode than our last one with Jericho.
Yeah.
It'd be a 3-hour episode.
All right. Well, I think I see somebody pulling up. Possibly. Is that flashing lights? Oh, there he is.
There he is. Dick the delivery man.
Thanks, Dick. What do we got?
Senior Dick running back to the truck.
Open that box.
I've been getting a lot of stuff in the mail. I feel like I've been overindulging in Amazon Prime.
Yeah, what's going on with that?
I don't know. It's just that thing where it's so easy.
That's like
is
there a
true.
Name for that? Is there like an addiction?
I bought 100
for that.
Shopaholic.
Is that all it is?
I don't know.
Is there a Prime?
Get
a Dr. Prime-aholic?
Nick on the fucking phone. Oh, or actually, better idea, don't.
I bought 10
not
pounds.
Not in the mood for him tonight.
I bought 10 pounds of oat bran on Amazon the other day.
You got a horse?
Well.
Yeah. Candy. You're an odd individual. Is that how you're stocking up on GERT? Just having it delivered to the door.
Yep.
Fucking
weirdo. I got a GERT deal happening.
Idiot.
So what's in the box?
Waste of time.
I'm a dew claw this week.
You're a waste of skin and life.
I've got here.
Luau your fat pig ass sometime.
I've got a Paul Stanley Wentworth Gallery item.
Wentworth Gallery item. Okay.
I've got the...
What's the Wentworth Gallery? Should I know this?
That's who deals his paintings.
That's
really?
Like it's like in malls and stuff, right? Or it's like a chain, Wentworth Gallery?
Is it?
Yeah, I believe that's the... Cause years ago when he first started doing like the painting thing publicly, selling stuff, what have you, probably, I don't know, 2007, 2008, in that window, wherever that was.
Yeah.
I went with my wife to the mall in Schaumburg because Paul Stanley was there
and there's
when they were selling
his art. Medieval Times is right there too.
You knock them both out in one trip. But you couldn't really meet Paul unless you bought something.
Right. It was that was how it was on the cruise as well. I think I must have met the guy who runs Wentworth Galleries because he laid the hard sell on us.
Yeah, and I don't know if pricing has changed, But I mean, at that point in my life, I might have been making $8 an hour, so I was not spending $1,400 on a print of Paul's. You know,
no, it was about right.
Bless his heart. I'm not criticizing his price. I'm just saying there's no way in hell it was in my range to buy anything. So I was like, well, guess I'm not meeting Paul Stanley. But I did lock eyes with him because people bought stuff, but it wasn't a constant line of people buying stuff. So no. He was just standing behind a table. We just stared, like as close as you guys are, we just stared at each other for like 2 seconds, kind of made a face, like a what's up, raise your eyebrows, hey.
And he's like, you going to buy something?
Honestly,
Duclaw.
Yeah. Honestly, he looked bored.
The Duclaw of the art gallery.
Well, how exciting is an art showing compared to what he's used to,
right.
Which is being, you know, running a Kiss concert.
Right. I mean, it's the complete opposite.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Flying over people, screaming, him screaming, crowd screaming, exploding things. Yeah.
Women stripping their clothes off. Mm. But yeah, I must have been the guy we dealt with on the ship. Nice guy, but
sure. Rules are rules.
Yeah, wasn't gonna plunk down. I thought about it, but it was a bit too steep. A little way too much of an extravagance.
Yeah,
I have to settle for my signed Gorshin that I have.
Well, next week I'm gonna see what I can do.
Yeah, what was that again? We were talking about. You're going to try and hook me up with? You don't want to reveal it?
I don't think. The odds of it happening are not good. But
oh, I remember now.
There's a possibility that I'm going to be able to get my hands on an autographed Morales.
That would be huge, man. If you could make that happen.
As an Esai Morales.
Oh boy.
Is there another?
Right. Just in case. In case listeners haven't been playing along at home with Chris's, I don't know. Stars he admires over the years, but
that would be big.
He may
man.
Be in the office coming up soon. So
that would be epic. Yep. I would be eternally grateful to make that happen. So
you display it proudly right next to your signed Gorshin.
I would.
Your signed Morales.
Get a wall going.
See if he'll sign a picture of himself as Frank Gorshin. So can you sign it, Frank Gorshin?
Sign a Morales as Gorshin?
Yeah, have him sign his own picture.
Tell him to sign it Paco Moreno, the character he played in Bad Boys.
That'd be good.
A tour de force performance.
Do you think it's
incredible
too...
Incredible movie. You've seen that?
I saw the first one years ago.
Not
that
the
one.
Fucking Martin Lawrence, Will Smith
I haven't seen it.
It's the Sean Penn
it's
movie,
It's the gritty
right?
juvenile prison drama with Sean Penn.
I'm afraid not.
Nick and I are more of a Martin Lawrence family.
You actually thought I was referring to the Martin Lawrence, Will Smith movie.
I might have thought so, yeah.
Idiot.
That was a bigger hit.
I don't care. Fucking step in and steal the goddamn title of a classic movie. You can't do that.
Lawrence could do
Fuck
what he wants.
Fuck those guys.
I heard there was a
go run around in some sweatsuit in 80, 90, 100 degree weather and didn't fucking knock on random people's doors.
Didn't Loudness have a hit
weirdo.
With Bad Boys years ago?
It's the same principle.
Do you think it's too hacky to ask Esai Morales to draw Woody Woodpecker?
Oh, man.
Oh, jeez. That would be good.
Do you think he gets that a lot or no?
No, probably right, not.
Then. If I see him.
It's just, say, can you yell Richie for me?
Yeah, I'm going to get my phone out.
React
just he'll write that across the picture, Richie, all capitals.
Woody Woodpecker yelling Richie. There you go. That's what I want.
That would be the best.
I'm going to try to make this happen if he shows up.
That reminds me of my Scotty Schwartz autograph.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, I want the black
say, man. It's not my first or my last.
Is that Bad Boys?
No, that's fucking La Bamba. When he finds out he's knocked the girl pregnant.
Right. There you go.
He's waving a shot glass of tequila under his nose. What a fucking brilliant acting performance.
Do you think that movie was written to be more about him than Babbo than Richie? Or do you think his acting performance
I think the whole,
led to that?
I think the whole thing changed when he was cast in the role. When Esai Morales is in your movie, he's going to take over. That's all
he absolutely did. I mean, it's about Richie Valens, but... Not really. Now, not as much.
If you don't want the focus to be on that character, you don't cast Isai Morales in the role. I'm just going to say that right now. Again, this is not something that I should be telling anybody. This is obvious.
This is common knowledge.
Yeah, if you can hook me up with a signed glossy, it'd be fucking great. It will go up above the Gorshin. I will put it above the signed Gorshin.
Gorshin as Riddler, correct?
Yep.
Yep.
Absolutely.
All right, Nick. So
back to
did you
I
use
guess.
Your Dew Claw to open the box?
I did.
Okay.
It is good for something. It's a 1,000-piece jigsaw puzzle. Of Paul Stanley's painting, it's an abstract painting, the Astral Autumn.
Mm.
Let me show you guys here.
I see.
Now, by looking at this, this is going to take about 12 years to put together in 1,000 pieces.
1,000 pieces. Jigsaw puzzles have never been my thing.
Well, and if it's something with like defined images.
Sure.
This is like a smear job.
You're just basically going off of the shapes.
It's a
fitting together. There's no picture connection.
It's not, the colors aren't really going to help you. It's just kind of paint smeared everywhere.
Once you get the Paul Stanley autograph together, you're on your own after that for the rest of the painting. That's the only
what
thing.
Is that like a bird bath in the lower right-hand corner there?
Down here?
Yeah.
It looks like a... Well, see, now this is like a Rorschach test. I'm almost seeing like a women's bottom bikini and top here.
Well...
Hmm.
Okay, now I'm seeing that, but my initial thought was a bird bath.
I see like nothing really.
No,
just colors. I don't know, but it's gonna take forever.
What if this was built on the canvas of a signed Gorshin?
Not a print, an actual signed Gorshin.
What a treasure
it is. My boy Scott Parenti to thank for that.
Mm. Oh, yes. I recall meeting him at your birthday party.
Yeah.
Punch
Andy's
it.
A I big didn't know fan. He had the Gorshin hookup. I would have gotten to know him years
well,
ago.
He went to what? He went to some RV show that he was appearing at or whatever, Comic-Con or whatever. But, yeah, he hooked it up.
That had to be many years ago because I think Gorshin's not with us
no,
for many years, right?
No, I had that tacked up in my cube at Playboy
I
for
remember.
Years.
I think that's when that's the first time I heard the phrase some signed Gorshin.
Not just
what it is. I
mean,
don't know what else you want.
I've worked
call
with
it.
People that whenever they take a training course, they proudly put the certificate of completion
oh, no,
up in their
no.
cubicle.
Andy will tell you what my cubicle was.
He'll probably tell you the whole thing.
I had a signed Gorshin in pretty much every ass-centric centerfold in the history of Playboy tacked up in my cube.
And you did have the centerfold from the Kiss issue tacked up.
True. With, yep. Yes, with the band and all the chicks. But
yep. if anything else was ass related,
if it was a single, if it was a single playmate in the photo, it was with the type of photo with her ass pointing at the camera,
looking over the shoulder, kind of
exactly.
Thing. Yeah, right.
The only way to go.
Well, right. Well, Frank Gorshin died in 2005.
Okay.
Okay. Anyway,
wow. That was a while ago. Shit.
Yeah. Yep.
So I'm going to go turn on the machine.
What's that?
The random song generator.
Oh, hold on. You going out there?
Yeah.
Do you need a hat?
No, because it's going to be warm out this
yeah,
week.
But it's not yet.
Well, yeah, it's Monday morning. It's not bad. It's in the 60s. Sounds like it's got spring fever.
Mm-hmm. Definitely does. I think a lot of us do.
Yeah.
After a winter that never really happened anyway.
Yeah, which whatever. Is fine with me.
Yeah, I'm not complaining. Whatever. So, it fired up.
It
how
did.
How do we make, what was it called? I'm sorry, I don't remember the name. Autumnal something? Astoria?
Astral Autumn.
Astral
Autumn. That was one of Chris's centerfolds, Astral Autumn.
ASS.
Yeah. That was the playmate's name.
Just made sense to tack that right up. Fit in with the motif.
Yeah.
Asses, Kiss, and Gorshin. Is,
the name of your autobiography.
Pretty much. It's all I need to make me happy.
Yeah.
And then the subtext will be in that order.
Right.
Okay, so how does this interact with the random song generator, which in another life was the George Michael sports machine?
I'm just going to put it on the conveyor belt by the scanner. Let it scan the pieces and see if it can assemble it virtually.
It's a belt. It's not a screw conveyor.
It's not a screw conveyor. Okay. No.
A belt.
Screw conveyor wouldn't help us right now.
Well, it would just jumble everything up.
It would.
That'd be a mess. Okay. Yeah. All right, you ready?
I am.
Got it on there?
It's going.
And away it goes.
Yep.
Beep, beep, boop, 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 look boop, boop. There it
look
is, printing out the
look
ticket.
Look at the way it does that.
This one comes off.
Dynasty.
It's called
2000 Man.
All right.
2000
nice.
Man.
When I heard Dynasty, I was like, oh, fuck, is it charisma? It's like I forget that I need to prepare for that every time I show up here.
That's like one of those things when you're really looking forward to a day, and then when that day comes, you're like, this is going to be a lot of work. The day is finally here, but I can't wait for it to be over.
No, I'm with you. I keep forgetting that I need to prepare myself for that possibility every time I show up here. And I wasn't, but this is like the next best thing. This is fucking awesome.
So, 1979,
yeah,
Dynasty, the only cover song on the album, the original, of course, by Mel Brooks and Carl Reiner.
Wait a minute.
Okay, anyway.
I could have played the Paul Stanley clip, but my hands
wait
are full.
Wait a minute. Rolling Stones.
Is your reference to?
2,000 year old, man. Oh, come on.
I don't know anything.
Somebody.
I'm just a boy. Explain
help
it to me.
You are just a boy. With your teal pants.
Who's going to stop me from wearing teal pants in my own home?
So you're looking up something? This is a...
I'm thumbing through the book.
As you're thumbing, I just want to say I'm going to be a broken record this episode and talk about how great it was when they busted this out on Unplugged.
Oh, yeah.
Which song that we've covered that they've done on Unplugged, practically, I've said. Because... every song that they did, the version on that Unplugged is excellent.
Every song,
yeah, every song on that performance is excellent. So
now was this the first one they did when he came out on stage? I don't remember what the arrangement was.
Well, it was both of them. Peter and Ace came out together. I remember that. I think it was. I think this is the song they busted into.
It wasn't Nothing to Lose?
Ooh.
I don't know.
You might
Who do we know? We have no business doing this show.
No, well...
Well, did they do any other Ace vocal tunes?
No.
I'm not as familiar
with
it.
He did part of a verse of Rock and Roll All Night, that's it.
Right.
But no other lead. And I don't know if it's in that book or not. I think it is, but Ace does talk about... how Shock Me was originally supposed to be the song that he was doing on Unplugged.
Right.
And this one was just easier, I think, with acoustic guitar.
That makes sense.
Limitations. I remember reading that somewhere.
I'm looking at the album for Unplugged, which I don't know if that necessarily was the order, was it? Shuffled at all?
Whatever the order of the show itself, yeah.
Okay, well, the album, 2000 Man, is the first one.
Okay.
Then Beth, then Nothing to Lose, then Rock and Roll All Night.
Okay.
So I apologize for being wrong again. But hey, I'm just a boy. What do I know? It gets me out of a lot.
Speaking of first, you know, as I've talked about a lot on this podcast, I had the 8-track version of Dynasty. It's back in the 70s. I had a hand-me-down 8-track system for my cousin, so... whenever I bought music, it was on 8-track, of course, and they always jumbled up, well, not always, but if they had to, they would jumble up the song order to make it fit on that format. And on the 8-track, 2000 Man was the opening cut, so for a long, long time, I thought that was just how it was on the album and the cassette and whatever else.
I understand they had to do what they had to do, but you'd think if the first song on the album was the big single, they wouldn't mess with the order. But hey, they did what they did. It's just kind of strange. you think you'd be like, all right, well, this one has to stay, then figure out the rest to make it work.
Yeah, it was just a stupid music medium, but
yeah, it was no
you know,
good, huh?
I was stuck with that for a while. So,
what was next?
I don't remember.
No,
I just remember this was the open.
Oh, I mean, in your life for system, music system, you went from 8-track to what?
To vinyl for a while, okay. And then CDs. I never was a cassette collector of buying them. You know, I had the blank cassettes and record shit off the radio, and then record LPs to cassette, but never really bought them like record label material.
All right. Well, 2000 Man, a couple comments from the book. Ace Frehley said, "That's a Rolling Stones song. A friend at a recording studio where I used to do demos came up with the idea to cover that song. He said, try it. So I jammed on it one day. It's a spacey song with spacey lyrics, so it fits my character. It's like the song was written for me. It's talking about computers and all that stuff." So there you go.
Oh, we love that.
But Ace talks about
We love when Ace talks about
technology.
Computers. Oh, it's the best.
Is that still a thing, or was that only like late 90s where he was talking about his fascination with computers?
I think he's, I don't know. He probably still does it.
Is it legit?
It's hard to tell.
Is he like a computer?
It's hard to tell because.
Scientist?
As far as what anybody can really decipher is that he's, you know, a rock star guy who can afford some great technology.
Sure.
Whether he is a master of it.
Well, when you don't pay your mortgage, you can afford a lot of stuff.
But does he have people that, you know, do the computer stuff
right.
too? Does he just kind of sit back and let them,
He's
know?
Fascinated with what the people do.
I guess.
So this song is about computers?
Sorry.
The fuck was that?
A swing and a miss?
It was a big miss. I guess. I mean, he says stuff about computers in it. All that stuff.
That's true. Yeah, this does have.
I mean,
I'm not
an expert on the lyrics, but I don't remember any fucking computer connotations. Is that they're talking about the year 2000 in this song title or what? I see. That's the thing. As big a Stones fan as I am, I've never heard the original version of this. So.
I don't think I've ever gone back and listened either.
I think once you hear this, you don't need to hear any other version.
Yeah,
I mean, you want to talk about a cover version that is just completely commandeered and turned into his own or Kiss's own. It's this one.
What if it's exactly the same?
I doubt it. I don't think that
I've
is.
Never heard it
I know
either.
It's off the probably Satanic Majesty's Request or something, that sort of weird psychedelic album they tried to do. I'm pretty sure it's on that album, and if so, it would be kind of like the way you described it. It would be all tripped out weird. I don't think it's a straight-ahead rocker like this one is. I'd be surprised. I guess one of these days I should get around and listen to it, but I have never heard it.
Vinny Poncia. That was Ace's idea to cover that Stone song, which is different than what Ace just said, but whatever. It was a good version. Knowing that the album was going to be a little bit left or a little bit right, Ace was trying to keep the lifeline open between old Kiss fans. 2000 Man is a real, raw, rock and roll song from the standpoint of how Ace feels and how he plays guitar.
Okay. That's what the doctor ordered right now, I'd say.
Mm-hmm.
I could go for that kind of music.
Sure.
So.
All right. Well, are you guys ready?
Yeah, man.
Let's do it.
Just wanted to comment on the drums.
Of course, you're going to comment on the drums.
The sound of the drums, that they're very powerful.
What do you hear there?
Nice punch, every single hit.
Mm-hmm. Who's playing those drums, Nick?
I'm thinking it's one Anton Figg from South Africa.
Hey, sure, baby.
It's my guess.
One of Nick's favorite human beings. Wouldn't you say that's accurate?
Nick's favorite African-American musician.
There you
go. He's up there in that category. Yeah.
No comment on the. Well, you're not one to comment on guitar tone. You're not. You're not
concerned with such things.
Well, you're not qualified to make that commentary. But the tone is great. Got a real nice bite to it, and it's cool how it's just guitar and drum at this point, and it's pretty. It goes on. Even for a while after the vocals kick in, so. Those kind of palm mutes that's going on, you know, most people associate that with heavier type music like Metallica and stuff, real syncopated stuff. But here we're hearing it in more just straight ahead rock context. And again, sounds great. Whatever signal path he's got going on, guitar, amp, whatever's happening is pretty much dialed in perfectly. That is as good a rock guitar rhythm sound as you're ever going to hear.
I'm trying to think of which Unmasked song those palm mutes sound like. There's one, I cannot think of it, but it's the tone of it. It's similar to something on Unmasked that we've covered. I can't think of what song it is, though.
You know what? It reminds me of a specific song, a specific palm mute, and also, you know, exemplary tone.
Great. Thug it up! Thug it up! Oh! Look for it right now! Yeah, pretty much nailed it there, I guess.
Yeah, I think so.
Same tone.
I have very good ears. I think Ace was playing a line six. Sure. It's probably a Squire through a line six. No? Squire. Daisy. Maybe a Daisy through a line six. Yeah. Well, my name, it is a number. It's on a piece of plastic film. And I've been growing funny flowers outside of my little windowsill.
Now, is the plastic film some sort of computer reference? I don't know. I don't know where. I do not recall any sort of computer connotations here. I think Ace is just making that up.
Well, later on he does, the word computer actually does come up in the lyrics, but his name is a number, so we've got some kind of, I don't know.
TVC-15?
Government has control and is, you know,
some sort of
tagging everybody.
1984 type paranoia about the future.
Yeah, so, yeah. Like
that could be it, yeah. But he's growing some weed on his windowsill, so he's trying to cope with it any way he can.
He's growing some computer weed on his windowsill. Yeah.
The word computer is in these lyrics?
Yeah, it is in 1979.
It's not coming to me. I don't know.
It's probably one of those computers that's the size of a room at that point.
Like in Mad Men when they got the computer, and then that guy freaked out because he was paranoid about it, and he cut his nipple off.
I remember that vaguely.
It's weird.
So that's what goes on
that
show.
The Commodore 64 was available in 1979, wasn't it?
I don't know. We had that thing in like 88.
Yeah.
I don't know when it came out.
It was the first computer a friend of mine had. And, what an abomination that thing was compared to what we have now.
Well, sure, but it was endless fun at the time.
Yeah, it was pretty cool, that's for sure.
Yeah. How about that? But don't you know I'm a 2000 man? Remember you had to like type shit to make discs do things? That just popped into my head.
And then it would say press play on tape and basically just turn off the computer at that point and start over.
All right.
There's no way to press play on
tape.
That
just gave me a weird flashback to having to write down like the colon and the slash and whatever, run and whatever.
Yeah.
Jeez, I forgot.
Was it, like Fortran or some shit? Yeah. Computer languages.
There were quotes and asterisks and yeah, you had to do everything just the right way.
Just to get the stupid disc that was just like a game to play. You'd think they would have figured out a way to just make it play.
Which was, well, basically when you got DOS, on the, you know, once the more modern DOS system came, then it was like, oh, this is kind of like Commodore 64.
Right.
You
got
to
yeah.
type the command exactly correct
sure.
to get it to do anything.
Right.
So I have to admit, until Chris said it, I didn't make the connection that the funny flowers was probably some sort of substance that may or may not be illegal in this version of 2000.
Yeah.
Didn't know. It's just a line I never understood.
Well, again, think back to the... actually, you might want to play that cut again. I want you to look it up and make sure that this out 2000 Man was originally on Her Satanic Majesty's Request, Rolling Stones. So have a look, please.
Do, look it up. Mm-mm-mm. Satanic Majesty's Request, yeah. 1967.
Yeah, so they were trying to get on the whole fucking, you know, psychedelic San Francisco scene vibe with this album, and so you know, drug references and whatnot were probably kind of a requisite thing to have in there. So
Sorry, I went back because we kind of cut it off, so just let's catch up here.
Vocally, he's really very up, much in the forefront of what we're hearing, which is good.
He's singing from the groin here.
He is. Sounds great.
Yeah, and, you know, there's just guitar and drums. So there's not a lot clamoring for space in this mix or in this arrangement.
And so there's not a lot to hide behind either as a singer.
No. He doesn't need to here. As we talk about a lot on here, you can tell when a guy is engaged in a song or when he's just phoning it in. This would be the former category. Brilliant move on his part to pick such a deep cut of the Rolling Stones. And again, he's made the song his own. I mean, this is one of those covers. You know, we could name off a few other ones, but this is one that it became, in my opinion, has become the property of the guy who covered it. So you know my wife still respects me, even though I really misuse her. I am having an affair with a random computer. Great lyrics, and again, you can hear the Jaggerisms in the lyric if you're familiar with how he put lyrics together. And, you know, it totally makes sense that this is a Stones cover when you hear a line like that.
I've never understood. Another line I've never understood exactly. Like, a robot? Is that what's going on? He's having an affair with a robot?
I guess.
It's a random computer. I'm guessing.
Why is it random?
I'm guessing
too?
It's not like a tower, you know, PC tower with a,
okay,
with a monitor.
So here we are. This is where the confusion set in for me.
Uh-oh.
That's not, I've never heard the lyric that way. I've always heard it as, I'm having an affair with a random commuter.
Oh, wow.
Meaning,
oh, okay,
somebody he saw on the commuter, bus, or train, or whatever.
Now, that had never occurred to me, because the version that I am more familiar with is the unplugged one, and he enunciates computer
pretty
explicitly there.
Yeah. But I would think that Jagger originally wrote it as commuter.
Everything I'm seeing is computer.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know. I always heard it as random commuter.
That's interesting, though, because that's kind of foretelling what the... I don't know. I don't even know what they call it now. But isn't there a program, like an app or something, where you kind of see who's in your vicinity if they want to have a random rendezvous?
Oh, what is that? Is that Tinder or is that...
I don't know.
I don't even know.
Well, I think it was big. Big in England a few years ago, I think.
Well, Grindr was the gay version of it.
That's what it was. Okay.
I think Tinder started out that way, but it's become a conventional dating site, from what I know. Well, I don't know. It's not my scene.
Well,
obviously.
Look, anytime there's a dating thing with women involved, it's going to turn into a conventional thing. Like if it started as a gay thing,
right,
which was just anonymous and, you know.
Well, and that's still that way.
Right. But Grindr. Then they try to make the straight version, and now it's like. Let's go for lunch thing.
Well,
and,
it's a regular dating site, from right. what I understand. But
women just can't have fun, can they?
Well, you know, we talk about it. They don't appreciate defecating, and you know, they're not down with the grind.
They don't appreciate a good pump and dump.
Well, you know,
we had that game for Commodore 64 as well.
Yeah.
Imagine the line of text you had to type in to get that one going. But
a lot of finesse, yeah.
Andy and I worked with a guy at Playboy who used to duck out for Grindr rendezvous on the regular, like
that's
at least three times a week.
Right? Yeah, that's when I first heard of it. I was amazed.
Well, I mean, just having the app itself. Kind of, you know, adds convenience to it. But back in the late 90s, the job I had before Playboy, I was the only, this small PR firm, and I was the only straight guy there.
Mm-hmm.
These guys would talk about their fucking hookups, man. Just off the chain. Oh. And that was like early internet days.
Dude,
no cell phones or anything, and these guys were just fucking getting laid constantly.
When two people want the same thing, you kind of accelerate the process a little bit.
Right.
I think that's what happens with two
dudes.
And
it's the other right, and the other thing is to remember that it just, yes, they're gay, but they're also men, meaning they want to fuck everything
right.
in sight.
If we're going to talk...
the fact that they want to fuck each other means they can just be constantly getting laid.
If we're going to talk old video games, being a gay man is basically like a warp zone in Mario Brothers. You just jump right ahead to whatever level you want.
Pretty much.
You go through the plumbing level, and what is that, level 1-2, and then run across the top and go to the warp zone. That's it. So... Whew. Don't you know I'm a 2000 man? And my kids, they just don't understand me at all. So you're saying that all the lyrics you're finding is a computer?
Yeah, even
the ones
the
that cite the Stones instead of Kiss.
I refuse to... No wonder I didn't put two and two together. I never fucking heard the word computer in there.
I mean, think about it.
It's like the guy, you know, my kids don't understand me, blah, blah, blah. You know, he's some workaday guy. He meets some hoe on the train and to get add a little excitement to his life.
It's either that or it's like straight up Jetsons at this point.
I thought it was like Jetsons. I thought that basically the 2000 man himself was kind of like a android of some sort.
Like some sort of sleazier George Jetson.
Like, I don't know.
But
this
like
is
a
all
Terminator.
Weird for me.
The Terminator.
Well, I mean, I thought that it was like, I don't know, like he wasn't fully human. Like there's some kind of element.
So he's a cyborg?
Cyborg, android, whatever it is.
Yeah, but you remember when the song was originally written in 67? That was like...
Well, the Jetsons were around, right?
These guys were getting
high. Yeah, I guess so. I don't know. I'm not going to ever hear it that way. I'm not always going to hear it the way I originally heard it, and it makes
commuter.
More sense to me.
Who thinks of that? Come on, commuter in a song.
It's the way I always heard it.
I guess so. It actually
makes sense.
It makes a lot more sense, but also the point of the song is to not make sense to me.
Oh, right. That makes sense.
It's just some weird...
I mean,
it's just put weird shit that's going to freak people on
like
drugs out.
It's like stream of consciousness, you know, writing. Yeah. Like Nick's favorite Mean Red song, Gasoline.
Was that...
Written by me, just complete random stream of consciousness nonsense.
Well, sometimes it works.
Yeah, exactly. You don't want to overthink shit if you don't have to.
It's never a good idea.
No.
There, how about that?
Yeah, this makes zero sense.
He's a computer. His brain's flashing.
Yeah, okay. Yeah,
I don't know what the oh mommy and oh daddy.
Well, I'm talking about planets and whatnot. Yeah. It's like science fiction or whatever, I guess so.
His vocal delivery, just he kicks it up there. He sounds fantastic.
He does sound good.
This is one of his better vocal performances.
Oh, God, yeah, are you kidding?
But
might be the best. Of
well, let's set. Slow down.
Well,
why should we slow down?
Because we all know the best.
Sure, baby.
Second best.
Well, we have yet
to.
Oh,
man. This
there's
is right
one
up
we
ha- there.
There's one we have yet to do that I would put above this one, but this one is great.
Yeah. Mm.
All right.
Like they did when you were young. Or did they come down crashing? Seeing all the things you've done. Spacing out.
I'm getting kind of a flashback to the New York Groove episode that we did not that long ago, where we're talking about how minimal the instrumentation was and the drumming particularly. And we're kind of getting that here. I mean, we have the chorus, you know, the big chorus of the song, and it's just, I hear like a maraca shaking and just kind of hits on the toms. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's very interesting. It's very stripped down. It's not what
it is a stripped down rock song.
Yeah,
here.
And I'm getting a New York Groove kind of. It's the different vibe, of course, because that one was a little funkier, groovier, whatever. But the same sort of strategy. It seems like.
Well, this is the most straight ahead rock tune on the album, and I can't think of another one that exceeds it in that regard.
Was this song influenced by New York Groove directly?
I don't know!
God.
You ready for the solo?
Sure.
Yeah, this is an interesting solo. Yeah, just roll it. We'll comment on it after.
The hell?
We were talking about, you know, computers and robots and junk like that. Those first couple of, whatever you want to call it, the first half almost of the solo, he's letting those notes kind of linger.
Mm-hmm.
And it's in my head, it was kind of, I don't know if it was on purpose, if this was what it was meant to do, but I was kind of getting a vision of like, you know, a robotic kind of movement. It kind of had that. It kind of resembled that to me, like almost
robotic
like
robotic movement,
almost like a
is
sci-fi
a scorpion song.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Just
almost,
about to say that.
Almost like a like an old sci-fi movie, like the big clunky robot.
Mm.
I just kind of moving awkwardly and
yeah, there is kind of like an abrasive,
like a grinding
sound to it. Yeah.
Hmm. Is it like Johnny Five or like before that?
Before that, Johnny Five was pretty rolling on his big track
wheel. Tracks. Okay,
treads.
So that doesn't work.
Yeah,
right. So it's more of like a weird, like a Japanese monster movie robot or something.
Yeah,
like
yeah,
that.
Like
Ultraman.
Yeah,
like when
remember
it,
that
when it walks or when the arms move, it's just big creaking,
stiff-legged.
Yeah,
like me going to the bathroom after I go to Wendy's.
Of course, there's
stiff-legged.
Very
lay across the toilet.
Boy.
Yeah.
Oh boy.
There's very very little futuristic about that approach to guitar playing though. That's basically you're getting that abrasion from the sort of the harmonics of the distorted guitar signal as he's slowly bending those strings up to sort of get that double stop. When you do that in the middle, like on his guitar solo, on like Alive 2, you can hear like these subtones like descending when he does it. It's kind of what's going on there. And he's also playing like your basic kind of Chuck Berry, Johnny B. Good lead lines there. So it's an interesting juxtaposition of such an allegedly futuristic song relying on just the roots of rock and roll there in the solo.
I mean, it works. If you look at it on paper, it's like, oh, this is like he just took parts of what he does almost all the time anyway and just only did this.
Yeah, and he kind of did like a rudimentary version.
Yeah, but it works.
Like he was drunk almost doing it slower.
But like if they were going for that conceptually, it does work. Even though if you look at it on paper, it's like,
it works.
It's like there's
under
nothing.
Any concept. I don't care what they're actually intending to do. That guitar solo absolutely works. I mean, can you imagine anything else there? I don't think so.
Series of computer modem sound instead.
Yeah, really.
90s modem.
Laboratory sounds left over from Gene's solo album.
Whatever demonic backwards Latin or something underneath it. You loved that. Radioactive. That was one of your least favorite, wasn't it? Your least favorite discoveries of songs you weren't especially
You know, I didn't like the bullshit intro of it, and I don't think I was a fan of it when we did the episode. No. I will say I gained a new appreciation for it when I heard it live on the cruise.
Just the song. They don't play that 2-minute intro or whatever.
Right, and just, you know, it was pretty, you know, on the cruise they couldn't have the pyro and stuff, so obviously you had the costumes and elaborate lighting anymore, but for a full makeup Kiss show is a pretty stripped down production, and you know, at the root of it, it's a pretty good song, but just the way it was presented on the solo album was not that great to me.
I heard a really cool version of it on Boat Candy when I went for a cruise.
Great, good one.
When you were young, or did they come down crashing?
Come down crashing like that joke is pretty much what
I
happened.
Actually don't know what that means.
You don't want to know
this
what it
is
means.
Like
it's just you
third
could,
or fourth.
You can
reference.
See the gears turning over here. It's like, how can I work in a Boat Candy?
I don't know what Boat
here?
Candy is.
You don't want to know what it is. It's a whole other discussion.
Okay.
God, but you see this mustachioed, simpering face over there. How can I work this? Yeah. Here's my chance.
When's he
going to
stop talking
in?
So I could talk about Boat Candy?
Idiot. No love for that Anton Figg sort of half-speed snare roll there.
It was nice. I have to say, though, I keep coming back to it. I think I prefer the performance on the unplugged version, the drumming, which was Peter, right?
Or was it Singer? Or was it both
Singer,
of them?
Or was it both of them playing?
I'm going to go Singer.
Or did Singer and Bruce leave the stage for those couple songs? And then come back for nothing.
We need
to
a refresher course.
I mean, I haven't seen
unplugged.
It in a while, but that's what I think happened. I think it's Peter on that one. No?
I don't know. I can't tell you one way or the other.
It has been a little while, so I'm second guessing everything here. Anyway, those drum fills from that performance is what I hear. These are fine, but I'd say I prefer the unplugged ones.
All right.
Which might have actually been Peter, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, well, he definitely played. It's whether or not
it was
Singer was up there with him.
I want to say they only did that for Nothing to Lose and Rock and Roll All Night.
I think you might be right.
Andy's going for it. 1,000 men and my kids, they just don't understand me at all. Don't you know I'm a two?
Nice little break down there, huh?
Just bobbing your heads, enjoying the song, huh?
Yeah, I was just, you know, during that segment, I was just thinking what a master stroke it was to cover this song. I said that earlier in the episode, but what a great choice and what a perfect execution of it.
And I am watching the unplugged version. Oh, as is Andy. I just see Peter up there.
Son of a.
So, in this particular case, I'm gonna take Peter over Anton.
There you go.
As far as
how about that?
As far as who swings the song better. But no complaints about. Little odd, unexpected. The way, you know, the minimalist kind of thing with the drumming, but it works.
Well, you know, again, Peter he's got that swing to his playing. I mean, it makes sense. You know, Anton Figg is, you know, he's more of a precise drummer. You know, I'll make the comparison I always make. It's like Steven Adler to Matt Sorum or Filthy Animal Taylor to Mickey D. It's like, you know, one is the superior technical drummer with impeccable time, but you know, you would come to appreciate that looseness in a guy's playing, and it adds a different flavor to it. So.
A long song.
Is it still
my contacts are drying out?
How much longer?
Like a 50
it's coming
seconds.
To the end, but there's another guitar solo.
Good lord!
What's the total time on it?
Forever. 4:55.
Yeah, that's the 5-minute song. That's lengthy. Not the tightest arrangement in Kiss recorded history.
No, just kind of jamming on this. This one part here for a while.
There have been boat candy excursions that took less time than this. And my kids, they just don't understand me at all.
Get a little levity at the end there.
Yeah, and we didn't mention Gene throughout the whole song, but I liked his bass playing on sort of that closing section where he was playing some of those melodic lines. Really added to it.
Yeah. What's Andy looking up?
Oh, I just
research. I'm trying to. Is he looking up if Gene actually played on
that's
the song?
Exactly.
I'm waiting
I'm
for Andy to say it was not Gene.
It was not Gene.
You're kidding.
Nope.
Was it Ace?
It was Ace.
Oh, all right.
Ace,
well,
Ace was big into playing his own bass parts.
That song was Ace and Anton and nobody else.
Wow.
So it could have been on the solo album.
All right.
Basically, yeah.
Okay. Interesting.
All right. It had a kind of a Gene flavor to the bass playing, though, wouldn't you agree?
It was doing those hammer-ons, those whole step hammer-on things that Gene does all the time. Yeah. It could have fooled me if you would have said, yeah, it's Gene. But, around this time period, it seemed like Ace took over his own songs, definitely guitar and a lot of times on bass. So there you go.
There you have it, 2000 Man from Dynasty, 1979. It is time to vote Hell or Hallelujah. Let's pass it over.
I wasn't really listening to him that closely, but do you think the like backing vocals, they're Gene and Paul weren't? Was it just like...
I didn't really hear any signature notes from them.
Hmm. Or Maybe it was a thing because they had Poncia producing it.
He, I don't know. He's credited with backing vocals in general, but it doesn't say specifically which songs.
Because I wasn't really paying that close attention to it. But
Poncia is.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Well, there you go.
Maybe. And keyboards.
Great. No tambourine for Poncia.
Maraca.
Andy's favorite instrument.
Nope.
Does Maraca get a pass or no? Is it in the same category for you?
I didn't hear any Maracas.
There was a little...
I mean, I can...
Was it a tambourine in there? There was a little percussion.
There was... There
were.
I'm pretty sure Maracas there toward the beginning.
Mm. Well, could be.
Maybe it's those plastic eggs.
Could have been, yeah. They had those back then. So, I'll vote first.
Okay.
I'll give it a hallelujah. Hallelujah! Mainly, the thing I like most about it is Ace's vocal performance.
Mm.
Weird lyrics, some actually a little bit awkward. You know, not something where...
The lyrics or the delivery of the lyrics?
Well, just because those are the actual words. There's
computer.
Really, yeah, there's really not a good, smooth way of delivering some of those lines, but Ace does a great job.
Is there a cool way to sing computer?
I don't know.
Say commuter.
Say commuter.
Cut out the P.
Yeah.
Exactly.
nothing to complain about. It's a great Ace song, and it's not one of my all-time favorite Ace songs, but, you know, I like it.
It's not?
No, it's not. I mean, it wouldn't be in my, like, top 10 Ace songs.
Are you insane?
It wouldn't be.
Insane.
But nothing.
In the context of Kiss, are you factoring in Fraley's comment into this nonsense?
Well, if we put Ace's solo album and just stuff he had done in Kiss, this one might not crack. It might not crack the top 10. I'm just saying that's just me rattling it off right now.
I don't that doesn't make any sense.
But
to me.
I have nothing disparaging to say about it. But you know, I'm kind of lukewarm to some of it. So who wants to go next? But I still give it a hallelujah. Don't get me
wrong.
Well,
you already did, yes. But the rest of it is just mind-boggling to me. Doesn't crack your top 10?
I don't think so.
Oh, God.
I'd have to take pen to paper to verify. But
are there even 10 Ace Frehley songs in the Kiss catalog?
Well, let's go through them. They're Shock Me. Do we count the solo album or no?
That's what I was saying. If we count the solo album.
So what's that, 8 more singing? Because I think there's 9. No Fractured Mirror. So that's 9. And then we've got 3 on Dynasty.
Yeah.
And we've got 3 on
Unmasked.
So
and then what?
15.
Into
and then,
the Void and blah, blah, blah.
But then don't forget The Elder. We've got...
I wouldn't count that one. That one's not that's not a threat.
But it's a song.
Yeah.
Didn't we take some heat on YouTube over that one?
Yeah, I think someone called us idiots because we talked about the percussive drumming during the solo. I forgot. It was someone really tore us up on that one. Pretty good, but I don't know. I lost count. What is that? Maybe I don't know. Somewhere between 15 and 18, something like
that. Well, whatever. I like it. It's really good.
If you get rid of the,
It's not a song that I go diving for to grab the CD to throw it in.
If you get rid of the solo album, there's probably
less than
10.
Then that's a different story altogether.
Mm, okay. Well, shit, man. Think about that. 10 songs. If 8 of them are from the solo album. And then they're Shock Me. Then that's 9 that are potentially better.
You would put 2000 Man beneath everything on his solo album?
Yes.
You're nuts.
That's
ridiculous.
Chris, why don't you vote?
Hallelujah, of course. Come on. This is... He turned this Stones cover into perhaps his signature song next to Shock Me.
Is that it?
Yeah, I mean,
okay. I mean, you don't need more if that's what you got. I didn't
know
if you wanted to.
I've got more, but I'm addressing this nonsense that he's come up with on here. It's not even his top 10. Get out of here with that. Give me a break. Mm. You saying you would put this like below Wiped Out?
It'd be close.
Oh, God. This is...
That's again, one where, depending on the mood...
It's so hard to pull off what he pulled off on this, which is to take a cover song. Yes, it was an obscure song, but still, to take a song by a band of the caliber of the Rolling Stones and to commandeer it and make it his own and put it right up there with Shock Me as a signature song, in my opinion. It's quite an accomplishment, so resounding hallelujah from me.
All right. I'm doing the math here just to get all the songs. Oh. There are 8 Ace songs, not including the solo album, 16 lead vocal songs, including the solo album. Oh, no, sorry. And then Into the Void. I would say that's the only one we'd count. We wouldn't count You Wanted the Best.
No,
a couple
no.
lyrics here and there.
Or In Your Face.
Yeah, so 17-ish if we count the solo album. Mm. Well, I'm going to give the song a big fat stinking hell. I've been sitting on that the whole
You've got to be kidding
me. The whole 194 episodes waiting to talk about this song.
You've got to be kidding me with this.
No.
This one has never done it for you? Or
never,
what?
Never, ever. No version.
You have got
ever.
To be. This is unbelievable.
This is a skip over every time.
You're fucking crazy.
If there are 17.
This is worse than Shout It Out Loud, man. What is wrong with you?
If there are 17 Ace lead vocal songs in Kiss, this is number 18.
Oh, boy.
This guy is just completely... I don't even know how to react to
this. I don't like this song at all. I'll give it some credit. I like Ace's delivery of the vocal. Nothing else about the song I like. I don't like the lyrics. I don't like the drumming. I don't
too
like
monotonous for
yeah.
you?
Yeah.
Like musically, just kind of the chords getting...
Doddering, boring, I don't know.
If that's how you feel.
It's not my thing.
Good, I hope you get fucking raked over the coals on this. You deserve it.
You know what? When you feel strongly about something, you have to go with your gut.
Go listen to Be Aggressive off the Faith No More Angel Dust album, or that fucking garbage.
I wasn't attacking you.
I don't care. go listen to your boy Mike Patton and all his horse shit that he's put out over the years.
Doesn't have any horse shit.
Shit. This shit's all over everything that guy has ever done. I hope you get destroyed about this. Give him everything you've got, potheads. This is outrageous.
Lay it on me.
Yeah. Run him into the ground for this.
How many people are going to agree with him, though?
Probably most.
Oh, God.
You'll be surprised.
There might be one or two.
This could be a turning point, this whole podcast. Now, this is unbelievable.
I want to discuss something you brought
up. I thought it was bad enough with this one over here on my right fucking talking about. I'm kind of lukewarm about it. But then this idiot coming out with this crap.
I don't think anyone likes this song as much as you do, including Ace.
What the fuck are you talking about?
Nobody
they
likes
busted
this song.
It out for fucking Unplugged.
Yeah, that was a weird rarity. I don't know. It worked.
There's 17 other songs he could have done.
Well, they played Coming Home. They played...
We're talking Ace vocals.
I know.
They pulled this one out because it's one of his signature
songs.
You know what
question I will pose?
This
is ridiculous. I honestly don't know.
Destroy this motherfucker, please.
I honestly
ruin him.
Don't know the answer
bury
to this.
Bury him.
But does he do this on his solo tours?
I don't remember.
I don't know that I've seen footage of him doing it.
That's what I was going to say. Now, maybe I'm way off. I'm not saying this to be outrageous. I'm not. I know what I said is an opinion. But I don't know that this is considered a signature Ace song. Is that true? I'm not being a dick.
Would he fucking do it at Unplugged?
I always thought it was because it was a deep cut. And that was Deep Cutville, basically. That's what Unplugged was all
about. But he wasn't in the fucking band anymore. They weren't going to go crazy deep cut. With a guy who wasn't in the band anymore. They wanted to do something that was a signature cut, and he said it would have been Shock Me, but it doesn't translate to acoustic as well as this one.
Hmm.
This is blowing my mind. I can't believe this. I'm interested now to see the reaction of the potheads at large. I can't be that off base on this. This is a high watermark for him. This is right up there with Shock Me, in my opinion. Fucking turned the song. He made the song his own.
Yeah. I'm just looking at some, I mean, they're random. A set list change, obviously, all the time. But it looks like on the 2016 tour, he was not playing it. That doesn't really mean anything.
No, I'm just curious.
But I was just curious, too. Yeah, if it's always...
One, if it's one that, yeah, he chooses to...
Yeah, I don't know, man.
To be part of his, whatever, the retrospective that is his career in a live setting in 2016.
Jesus. Well, I'm ready to get buried. I don't know about you guys.
Well, I mean, you might have somebody agreeing with you out there. I'm in the middle. I like it more than I dislike it. But, well, I'm here in the middle of two extremes.
I thought this was, there's no guarantees on this show, but I thought this was a guaranteed SKKK, to be
really?
Honest with you. And I started to get a little worried when I listened to this clown and talking about lukewarm about it, and then this fool
that ruined it
comes out with his crap, this Faith No More.
I didn't say anything
listening.
About Faith
I'm
No More.
I'm bringing it up because that's because your love of that band compared to this. Give me a break.
All right.
Well, garbage music.
I didn't do it to incite any kind
reminds
of.
Reminds me of that quote from the Nitro video that we found.
Was it dickhead music?
Yeah.
This is dickhead music.
Yeah.
Or something.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I didn't voice my opinion to incite
any
kind of negativity.
I was not expecting this outcome.
Again.
I thought this was in the parlance of Mr. Mustachio over there, I thought this was a slam dunk. And like I said, man, started to get the clouds were rolling in with Nick's assessment and then your fucking brother... puts the kibosh on it completely.
I was surprised. I was surprised last week that Heart of Chrome didn't even get a hallelujah from you. So
yeah, I mean, there's.
I would have thought for sure if I had to put money down one way or the other. So you just never know.
This is a Heart of Chrome receipt right here.
Yeah, but Heart of Chrome is not.
It doesn't have the stature, the status,
exactly.
Whatever that this one has, but. But I'm just saying that to draw a parallel. Last week I would have said, "Oh yeah, this is going to get a hallelujah."
Yeah, in my mind, all three of us were hallelujah. I was like,
yeah.
"Oh, is this one going to be a classic?"
Yeah.
I was already in the next round last week.
Yeah, and that sounds like that's where Chris was.
And going in, I had that mindset because, as you know, aside from the two cuts that won't be mentioned, I'm a huge Revenge fan. But as we delved into the song, you know, it wasn't a resounding send it to hell like Andy pulled on this one.
Andy tends to do that.
When he
sends it down, he really sends it down.
Well, here's what it is. I have to psych myself up because at the core of myself, I'm a coward, and I just want to go along with the group. But I know that's not what we do on this show. I don't want anyone mad at me.
Well, that's the other thing. I changed my attitude on Heart of Chrome during the episode. He's been harboring this fucking attitude for years.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable. Lay into him
or
as you never have before.
But,
I mean, this has got to stop.
But let's be fair. If you agree with me, let me know. I want to know. Am I insane?
I'm interested for that same reason, too. Am I insane for thinking that this is one of Ace's signature songs and it's a high watermark not only for him but also the whole fucking band? This song is a fucking classic.
I didn't know you felt that strongly about it, to be honest with you.
Well, and on the flip side, yeah. I didn't think you felt so strongly on the other side.
Well, you know, sometimes this happens, and guess what?
That's just the fucking way it is.
That fine. Is. Stamp it up. It's, yeah, whatever.
We can't really argue it.
Astonishing.
It is.
I don't know. It's weird. This is more divisive than the Shout It Out Loud thing. The Shout It Out Loud I could get because you know you've heard it over and over and you're sick of it. But this is there's another Shout It Out Loud looming in the horizon from my standpoint. So we could have this vibe on an episode again. But
we might
this one's completely out of left field. I will be interested to see what the consensus is from the listeners.
Yeah.
One of us is completely has his head up his ass.
Nick
and I don't think it's me.
Nick might be the one everyone's on the same page with. Who knows? I don't know.
Well, if I guess if
the unplugged version didn't do anything for you, it didn't reignite any sort of interest in the song.
Nah, it's okay. That's all. Nothing else.
I like it. I've been saying I like that one even better.
Chris
than
isn't
this
gonna
one.
Be able to sleep tonight.
No, I'll sleep fine. Okay. I just it's ridiculous.
The driver on the block. Yeah. Well, I don't know what to tell you. It's ridiculous. But as Paul Anka said, that's just the fucking way it is.
All right. So anybody find any piss and vinegar on YouTube this week? I wasn't actively looking.
I found one.
What do you got, Nick?
Believe it or not, another Scorpions 50th anniversary.
You know, we're getting a lot of good material from the Scorps on this program.
Yeah, we owe them something, all the material. And, you know, just in general for YouTube comments, something I've noticed that usually triggers a fight is a band that's had replacements of, you know, key members. Yeah, that's where there's always a fight's usually rooted in that. But
which is most bands, so there's a lot of material.
But, I mean, that's usually the topic that starts it. It's this person was better, or this person's way better than, and then it's you're an idiot, and then there you go. We're off for the races.
The only band you don't really get that is Aerosmith, but you still might get some people saying that for that couple of years they preferred the lineup without Joe Perry and Brad Whitford.
I wonder if anyone ever said that.
I would be among that crowd.
Really?
Rock and Hard Place is the only Aerosmith album I've ever owned.
Wow. Well, there you go.
Okay.
There's one.
There's another astonishing statement made on the show. it's just a roller coaster this year.
It's not that I dislike Aerosmith's one of those bands where it's like I fucking heard so much of them on FM radio that I just didn't need the albums, you know?
Yeah.
And everybody, you know, guys my age are always like, man, you got to get Rocks or you got to get Toys in the Attic, the deep cuts. Like, you know, I'm not fucking interested. I don't care.
I would agree with the Rocks statement. That's absolutely.
Like masterpiece.
Yeah.
Everybody
says? It's up there. Yeah.
Yeah. I guess one of these days I should take the plunge. I'm just not motivated. Aerosmith doesn't excite me. I don't know why. They should.
Well, I don't know.
Yeah, I guess it's just one baffling assessment of music after another on this episode.
This is a bizarro episode.
Yeah. I was not expecting that at all. I got to admit, I was blindsided by that. I thought it was to me, that's like somebody, busting out the Hell clip for Rock and Roll All Night and saying it's one of Kiss's worst songs. This is on that level for me.
Wow. See, I didn't know you.
I'm shocked by that. No pun intended.
We're both shocked.
Yeah. Well, we'll see what this will make it interesting. We'll see what the listeners think. Wow. All right. So
what do you got, Nick?
Let's close this thing out. I'm still kind of shaking out the cobwebs from the voting.
I've got somebody stirring the pot here. Let's see.
For what video is it?
It's the Savage Amusement 50th Anniversary Deluxe Edition, full album.
Okay.
Wasn't that the point of contention of the last YouTube dust-up is the whole 50 years thing?
Yes.
So they're talking about the 50th anniversary of the band, right? So obviously Savage Amusement was like late 80s, right?
Something like that. I forget exactly what the year was, but
Savage Amusement. What a stupid title.
Doesn't even go together.
That's just dumb. We were talking about this earlier, amongst ourselves, but they're kind of like Kiss, where, 70s band and transitioned over into the 80s and embraced the whole Sunset Strip sleaze hair metal vibe, and I think Kiss did it better, but they had some success with it. But I mean, savage amusement. The rhythm of love and passion rules the game. I mean, what garbage.
Many times on this podcast, we've been amused by the... Like
Faith No More level music.
Savagely amused by the...
complete trash.
By some Scorpions lyrics and album titles and song titles. It's just very, very... I guess amusing would be a good word for it.
So what's the dust up you're finding?
Andy, you find it?
No, I thought you had it.
Okay, I got it right here.
Yeah. Well, am I reading it?
You're the guy who's...
Yeah, you're the guy who does.
Why didn't I always did?
You're the guy that navigates all this.
Okay, I'm sorry.
I don't think I could deliver.
You're the guy who shits on iconic Kiss songs, and you're the guy who presides over the YouTube dust-ups.
Okay. So am I starting at the top here?
Yeah, just the
okay. Remember, give the handles to these people.
This is Gregory... Oh boy, C H R I. What a Gregory Cree.
Whatever.
Yeah,
I don't know.
We'll call him Gregory Cree. All right, moron. Period. This crap album isn't 50 years old. Why did he add crap album? Isn't
he's
he on
right?
That? But I mean, isn't he there because he likes it?
He clicked on it. Yeah.
Well, that's a whole other discussion. Why people land on these videos.
Moron. That, I'm sure that's addressed to the person who posted it, right?
Sure.
That's the title. So I think this is the same person here. Vinicius Oliveira. Read this. And then it's the Blabbermouth article about the Scorpions 50th Anniversary Deluxe editions of classic albums. Then Gregory Cree, whatever. No! Exclamation. This album isn't 40 years old. Yeah. Edit your post! Exclamation.
Yeah, he's just not getting it, but... edit your post.
It's the Scorpions actually released it as a 50th. That's what the...
Right, his issue is with the Scorpions.
It's not with this guy, yeah.
Whatever. You know, that's the chance you take when you post other bands' music and, you know... Love it when people put that disclaimer, like, I do not own this music.
Of course,
I'm just putting it up there for everybody's enjoyment. It's like this, as if that absolves you of any sort of legal ramifications. All right, what else? Is it back and forth?
Well, it's like five people. It's going to be hard to keep up, but the comments are worth it. So a guy named Thomas Camper is piping up. Crap, you're the moron. So there we got that.
Did he get your right or...
Yes, he did.
Oh, good.
But he capitalized moron for some reason.
Because he's angry.
Yeah, but only one. Only the M.
I like that. I can get on board with that.
Yep. So James Monroe, James with a Z at the end.
Our fourth president.
Yep.
Our fifth president.
So, the second and fourth word of this four-word sentence are in all caps. Ready? With three exclamations at the end. The crap is you. this is good stuff. Gregory
Cree. Goes on, huh?
Gregory is the original guy who called everyone a moron.
Yes,
remember?
Gregory.
Gregory comes back and he says, a thread of morons.
Wow.
James Monroe, who just said the crap is you. You stupid fuck.
Wow.
That's it? Just you stupid fuck.
You stupid fuck. Okay. Gregory, his response, James is big stupido. James Monroe, all caps with three exclamations. You motherfucker.
That's
all this. And what Scorpion song is it? The whole album. Okay.
Next we have Gregory again. You pendejo fucker. And then the final comment. James Monroe. This is where it ends. And by the way, this started... 2 months ago, and finally this is 1 week ago. So they're going back and forth like every week or so. They're just adding another comment. So the final comment in this thread from James Monroe, I'm going to fuck your dirty ass, you fucking moron. So there you have it. I guess we wait for Gregory to respond, but that's where we're at. The crap is you.
Yeah, we might have to. We should like fan the flames of that. We could get involved in that little.
We should go in there and just start. You know, I don't know, inciting. What's it called in hockey? Instigating. instigation penalty.
Yeah.
Whatever.
That's
we should start doing that.
I don't know. There's always somebody that comes on. Another one I've noticed, because like how the guy started it with moron, kind of not directing it specifically at anybody.
Yeah.
So it almost sounds like anybody that likes this album is a moron.
Yeah.
So he's going to get a lot of responses, of course, from that.
Yep.
You get people doing that who kind of have the thing of, I just walked in the room and I'm here to... I'm the center of attention. And
basically,
I'm not afraid, Steven Seagal and Out for Justice. Yeah, I'm not afraid of any of you.
Steven Seagal with his eight ball wrapped in a bar towel.
Much, right, yeah.
And you get that, and then you get the...
Whose hot dog is this?
You get the...
Moron!
Moron, yeah.
This crap album, yeah.
You get that, and you get someone who comes on with the same kind of attitude. I've noticed this in kind of reading comments lately. Who will look at, they love this album, they'll look at how many people gave it a thumbs down at the point where they were posting, and something extremely derogatory, including the number
182 shit for brains.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Yeah, you get, there's that.
Mentally ill shit for brains.
Yep, that's it. Should just post that on every video that has thumbs downs.
All right,
or the opposite for thumbs ups, if you want to start real fights.
Well, you can go on 2000 Man video and say the 5,000 likes of these people are all stupid.
We could.
We might have one of these arguments on our own thread this week.
Yeah, we might.
So, I mean, seriously, this is, like I said, I think this will be the most controversial voting outcome since Shout It Out Loud. And that one I kind of understood. This one I just don't get. So
we're gonna find out.
We will find out at that.
Someone might call me a pendejo fucker. So we'll see.
Gonna fuck your dirty ass.
All right. Well, are we done? I think we're done.
Let's end this.
Who's the winner in that situation anyway?
I'm not sure.
There's no winner there.
When a dirty ass is involved, there are no winners.
Some sort of, you know, prison yard domination going on.
Yeah. The winner loses.
Yeah,
no, exactly. Is it called the winners lose? I forgot.
The winner loses. Count. What? Yeah. Which, by the way, we're recording this episode on the 60th birthday of One Iced Tea today.
Wow. Happy birthday, Iced Tea! 60 years old, huh?
They call it going out the back door. So,
yeah. Well, hey, we're out of time, but next Monday, you're invited to the podcast event of the week, episode 195 of Pot of Thunder. Be there.
If he was boning a lot, he'd have a much different disposition, let's put it that way.
Yeah.
He wouldn't be such an enigma.